Om Asato Ma Sadgamaya Tamaso Ma Jyotirgamaya Mrityur Ma Amritam Gamaya Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Om, lead us from the unreal to the real. Lead us from darkness unto light. Lead us from death to immortality. Om, peace, peace, peace. Good morning. And a lovely day as usual in San Diego. You know, you're spoiled here in San Diego. Yeah, the best weather in the whole of the United States. I just heard yesterday somebody was saying that there are more than 300,000 church congregations in the United States, all religions included, all kinds of religions. All kinds of church congregations, more than 300,000. In almost all of them, the language spoken, the religion taught, is a language and religion of faith. Almost all of them. Where we are told that here is the truth revealed by such and such teacher, and here are the sacred books. Believe in this and behave accordingly. So if you are nice and you are not naughty, then you get to go to heaven. What proof is there that this is true? Well, you'll get the proof, but you have to die first. It's a post-mortem proof. It's a post-mortem religion. And that's all right. That's all right. It's based on faith. That's why another name for religion, which is common nowadays, is faith. I think that's a bit misleading. It's not incorrect, but it's a bit misleading. It's a bit limiting. Not all that there is to religion. In fact, it's not even the central core of religion. So that's one language. The language of faith, the language of you must believe this, language of do's and don'ts, and something you will get from it post-mortem, after death. There is another kind of religion. 100 years ago, Swami Vivekananda came to this country and he spoke a different language. He spoke not the language of faith, not the language of believe me, but the language of experience. He spoke the language of experience, that God is something to be experienced. Whether we have an immortal soul or not is something to be experienced. The results of religion, attainment of bliss, getting permanent peace, overcoming suffering, is something that we must experience in this life. He says that I do not believe in a religion which promises me heaven after death but cannot wipe the widow's tears or put a piece of bread to a hungry man's lips in this life. So a religion which must give us results, tangible results in this life. What is promised, we must experience now. And religion becomes a matter of experience. He taught what is called yoga. Now it's a common word, everybody knows. Yoga. This week we are celebrating the International Day of Yoga all over the world. And it all started, the worldwide yoga movement started with Swami Vivekananda. More than 100 years ago when he came here, he spoke about the methods, the principles by which we can make religion living, we can make religion a matter of experience in this very life. So there are practices, not do's and don'ts, but practices. There is a reason why we must practice those things, and there are clear results which are expected. Those are set out in the different yogas, especially in the Raja Yoga, which he taught, the yoga of meditation. But I'm not going to talk about that today. We're going to talk about something else, a third kind of religion, which Swami Vivekananda also spoke about, which is neither just faith or belief, not just do's and don'ts. It is not even the yoga techniques which will take us, if you practice them sincerely, which will take us to extraordinary experiences, to a certain vision of God or some kind of extraordinary experience which proves to us that religion is true. But there is something more. At the core of Vedanta, in the Upanishads, we find another kind of approach to religion, where it says, you don't have to believe what we say. You don't even have to wait for an extraordinary experience. What we need is, can we look at our daily experience? Can we look at what is available to us today, right now? Can we look at that, and can we find God there? Not as a matter of belief, not in heaven afterwards, not even through certain particular practices which will give us some peculiar experiences from which we can get knowledge of God, there's no doubt about it, and that's very true. But looking at our life right now, all that we experience day to day, can we find God here and now? One is the language of faith and belief. One is a very scientific language of practice and experience. Another is the language of knowledge. Language of faith, language of experience, language of knowledge. It is this third one which concerns us today. How can we find God here and now? You see, in Vedanta there is a peculiar problem. When Vedanta talks about the ultimate reality as Brahman, as existence, consciousness, bliss, and says that it's everywhere, it's omnipresent. If it is everywhere, it must be here. It is eternal, always there. If it's always there, it must be now. And it is non-dual, there's no second thing apart from it. Then all these things are in some sense not apart from Brahman. It follows directly. What is the problem? The problem is this. If I say God is there in heaven, then I'm safe actually. If you ask me why can't I see God if God exists? I say he's in heaven, that's why you can't see God. You will see God after you die. Now you can't catch me anymore, because then you have to wait and see whether I told you the truth or not. But if I say God is right now, right here, and nothing in your experience is different from God, I'm using words carefully, then you have a right to ask, if that is so, then why do I not experience God? If it's right now, right here, I should experience God. Something is present right here, right now, I should experience God. Present all the time and everywhere, then I should experience God all the time and everywhere. In every experience, I should experience God. What does Advaita say to that? In every experience, I experience the world, I do not experience God. Neither outside nor inside, nowhere. What do you say to that? You can't hide, you can't say that it's in heaven. You have just said it's everywhere. Now, what does Advaita say to that? And Advaita Vedanta makes a remarkable claim that it is true that God is omnipresent, God is eternal, and this divinity can be experienced everywhere, all the time, in every experience. It can be done. How do you do that? That is, no less than that is the subject for this morning. And I think it's a good way of ending this season of lectures, you know, sort of summing up the essential teachings of the Upanishads of Vedanta. Well, let's see how. Let's see how we can discover God in every experience. That is the promise. Let's see how we can do it. Swami Vivekananda said, one of the remarkable things about Vedanta is that they take up the most commonplace things. In the Upanishads, they take up our commonplace experiences and try to find divinity there. We'll see just now what it means. Also, another remarkable thing is, we don't have to search outwards. We don't have to go to some heaven or the Vaikuntha, the abode of Vishnu, or Kailasha, the abode of Shiva, to find God. Vedanta tells us you look inwards into yourself. Look inwards into yourself. All these elements you find now. Let's just go into the subject we'll find now. In the Keno Upanishad, which I had occasion to discuss in passing I think a month ago, when I spoke about the light within. I'm going to take that up again, but in an entirely different angle. The student asks the teacher, and note the question. Kene shitam preshitam patati mana, kena prana prathama prayiti yukta, kene shitam vacham imam vadanti, chakshu shrotram kaudeva yunakti. The student asks to the teacher. We don't know who the teacher is, we don't know who the student is, there no names are there. But this question is remarkable. The question is, by what light, by what power, by what inspiration does my mind think thoughts? How do I think? How do I get this experience of thinking, feeling, understanding, not understanding, this thing going on within me all the time, our inner lives? By what light is it lit up? By what light do I breathe in and out? By what power? By what power do I speak these words? By what power do I get the experience of seeing, of hearing? Now note something about this question. He's not asking about a God out there. He's asking about something within us, number one. Number two, he's not asking about something extraordinary. Now, by what practice will I see Shiva? Or by what practice will the angel Gabriel reveal himself to me? Nothing extraordinary, nothing supernatural. He's just asking a question, not even asking, how do I get Nirvikalpa Samadhi? No, no, no. He's asking something that's common to all of us all the time. How do I see? How do I hear? How do I think? What light within? That's one extraordinary thing we notice. It's something about which is within us in our day-to-day experience. Nothing extraordinary. And the second thing is, note carefully, he is not asking a question which you can ask a doctor or a physiologist or a biologist. He is not asking, how do I speak? He's not asking about the mechanism of speaking. How do I see? He's not asking about the visual system. No, no. How do I know that he's not asking that? Because each of these are different systems. Seeing is a different mechanism. Speaking is a different mechanism physically. Hearing is a different mechanism. And psychologically thinking is a different mechanism. So these would be separate questions. But you know what he's asking? Note the question. He's asking about the one thing common to all of this, which lights up our thinking, seeing, hearing, speaking. So when you are asking about one thing, you are not asking for an answer about the biology or the physiology of seeing or hearing or thinking. You are asking for something deeper than that. He's asking for what gives us this experience, the first person conscious experience of life. What is it that lights up this movie, perpetual movie we call our lives, my life? That's the question. And the answer is direct and powerful. The teacher says, Shrotrasya shrotram manaso mano yad vachoha vacham sau pranasya prana chakshushas chakshur atimuchya dhira pretya asmad lokadamrita bhavanti. Now this verse, this answer is powerful. It contains a direct answer to that question, how to realize this and what benefit you get from it. First of all, the answer to the question. You wanted to know by what light, by what inspiration, what power you get the experience of hearing. Yes. It is the ear of the ear by which you hear. By what do you see? It is the eye of the eye by which you see. By what do you think? By this time the student must be saying, don't tell me. I know. By the mind of the mind. And I speak by the speech of the speech and I hear. What strange language. Whatever does he mean? What he means here is remarkable. What the teacher means here is, when you use language like the eye of the eye, when you use language like the eye of the eye, first of all, you mean something different from the eye. Otherwise, he would have said, how do I see? You see with your eyes. But he says, no, you see with the eye of the eye. You hear with the ear of the ear. And you think with the mind of the mind. You think, speak with the speech of the speech, and so on. Now, remember, It's one answer to many questions, which means he's also saying the ear of the ear, the eye of the eye, the speech of the speech, the mind of the mind, all of these are not different. Eyes, ears, speech, mind, these are different. But all of these, the ear of the ear, the eye of the eye, the mind of the mind, the speech of the speech is one thing, he says, which is different from all these mechanisms, which pervades them, which makes them function. Very much like if I ask, what is that which makes the microphone amplify my speech? What is that which makes the lights shine? What is that which makes the air conditioner give cool air? And you would say, electricity. Electricity is something quite different from the microphone and the lights and the air conditioner. And yet, it's being different from all of them, yet it enters into all of them and does different things in different places, enables these different mechanisms to do what they were designed to do. In the same way, there is something called pure consciousness, which is what the teacher says, which shines upon our mind, enables us to cognize, to think, to feel emotions, which shines through the mind into the visual system, which gives us the conscious experience of seeing. You see a sensor in an airport bathroom tap, washroom tap, a sensor, that can also see in a certain way. You put your hand before it, it will give you water. So in a certain way, it senses. But in there is no conscious first-person experience of seeing. Right? I can prove it to you. The difference between you and a sensor in a washroom tap. Or a door, go to the door in the supermarket or a mall or an airport, and the door opens when you walk close enough to it. There's a sensor. It's in a certain, say, within quotes, it sees you in a certain sense. But it's very different from us. How is it different? When I open my eyes, I see all of you. If I close my eyes or if I were to go blind, I would say, I am the same consciousness which was able to see all of you through my eyes. And now, I'm the same consciousness, I cannot see anything. Whereas the sensor, if it's broken, it's nothing anymore. It was something which was able to behave in a particular way, and if it's broken, it doesn't work anymore, it can't see you, there's no consciousness within which will say, oh, I am broken now. I can't see when anybody's coming. When do I know? How do I know when to open the door or to give water? No, there's no such consciousness within. It's a simple thing. It's there all the time within us. So that is what, like electricity pervading all these instruments and making them do what they are doing. In the same way, there is a pure consciousness within us which pervades our body and mind, shines upon them, and enables all these systems to do what they are designed to do. Eyes to see, mind to think and feel, speech to speak, these experiences which we get. But that still leaves one question unanswered. When I asked you, what pervades the microphone and the light and the air conditioner and making them do what they do, you immediately gave me the straight answer, electricity. And if the teacher wanted to say consciousness, why didn't he just say so? The student asks, what makes my mind think? What makes my eyes see or ears hear? So why didn't the teacher just say consciousness? Why did he use such strange language? Ear of the ear, eye of the eye, mind of the mind. Well, there's a reason. He's actually not trying to confuse us. He's trying to help us here. To actually locate and understand what is meant by pure consciousness. You see, the problem is, that's why it's so simple and difficult at the same time. The problem is, all that we are accustomed to know throughout our lives, everything that we are aware of are objects, things apart from us. Here, I know all this room. They're all objects to my eyes. You hear the sound of my voice, but the sound is an object to your ears. You're aware of your own body, but the body is an object to your five senses and your mind. We can even sit and think subtle thoughts, powerful thoughts. A mathematician thinks so many subtle and difficult thoughts. But even the thoughts are objects to the consciousness of that mathematician, is it not? So all that we are aware of are either objects. Some objects are gross objects in the world outside. Some objects are like our body, which are very close to us, but still tangible. Some are little more subtle, like the breath. But it's also an object. By object, I mean object of your consciousness, of your awareness. You are aware of it. By object, I mean anything that you are aware of. Something more subtle. Your thoughts, emotions, your whole idea about I, me, myself. Those are also subtle objects. Just, they are thoughts, they are ideas, they are memories. But they are also objects because you are aware of it. Are you not aware of your own memories? Of course you are. I am happy or sad. That happiness or sadness or misery, that is also an object. Why? Because you are aware of it. Anything that you are aware of, anything that we are aware of is an object. A gross object or a subtle object. The moment the teacher will say, the God you are searching for, the divinity you are searching for, the self you are searching for is consciousness, what will we try to do? We'll immediately start searching for consciousness in the realm of objects. We'll immediately start searching for consciousness out there. Out there, we may not start searching for consciousness as an object, but at least we'll start searching for consciousness in our own minds. Which one is consciousness? We'll try to say, let me try to experience the consciousness. All the while we'll be feeling, let me try to experience consciousness as an object. Whereas it is not an object. Consciousness is not a thing. It's not a thing. It is the knower of the thing. It is the very subject, himself or herself. You see, even himself or herself depends on gender, which is the body, which is also an object. So consciousness is beyond gender. It's beyond the body, beyond the mind, transcending all of that. It's not an object. The moment you say it's not an object, the problem comes. You think that, okay, so it's nothing. You see, since we are accustomed to seeing and experiencing objects only, the moment you deny all objects, the doubt will come. So that self, that God, that Brahman, whatever you talk about, it's nothing. Do you understand the problem? If it's not a thing, it's nothing. That's how we think. That's how we are used to. But the subject, the consciousness, pure consciousness itself, is neither a thing nor nothing. It's the subject which is aware of things, the presence of things, and the absence of things which we call nothing. Both things and nothing are all both illumined by the same consciousness, which is not one thing among many things. One good example is the eyes themselves. How do I know that you are all here? Suppose I'm a particularly foolish person, I say, okay, the proof of existence is that I see you. You are all here because I saw you. Right? Very good. Now, if somebody says, now there is something called the eyes by which you saw everybody. I say, no. Where are the eyes? I can't see the eyes. Anything in this room exists because I see them. Right? Now, somebody says, there is something called the eyes by which you are seeing everything. I say, no, but where are the eyes? Is these the eyes? Are these my eyes? Are these my eyes? No, nowhere in this room do I see anything called my eyes. So my eyes do not exist. If the proof of existence is seeing something, but I don't see my eyes. None of you see your own eyes. So, but I can see a reflection of my eyes. You can see a reflection of your eyes, but not the eyes directly themselves. Eyes cannot see themselves. But what is the proof that you have got eyes? By seeing what will you know that you have got eyes? By seeing anything. By seeing anything, it's a proof that you have got eyes. By saying, speaking anything, it's a proof that you have got a tongue. Right? Even though the eyes do not see themselves, just by seeing, we get a proof that I have got eyes. In the same way, though the consciousness is not an object which it can be aware of, but by being aware of things, by being aware of objects, gross and subtle, it's a proof that it is conscious, it exists. It is that by which you see, it is that by which you hear, it is that by which you think, it's that by which you get the feeling, which we get the feeling of speaking. So, it's not a thing, but it's not nothing either. In the Upanishads, when we hear neti neti, you've heard this word, neti neti, it means not this, not this. How do you apply it? What is consciousness? What is pure consciousness? What is Atman? What is Brahman? It's not anything in the world outside. So it's the body. It's not the body. Is it the vital forces, breathing, blood circulation, assimilation? Vital forces, prana? Not that. Is it the mind, thoughts, emotions, memories? Not that. Is it the intellect or the ego? Not that. Is it the complete blankness I experience in deep sleep, Anandamaya Kosha? Not that. Okay. So none. You have just dismissed everything in the universe. So it's nothing. What you're talking about is nothing. The Upanishad says, not that. It is you yourself. And that's why it's so difficult to grasp. The teacher tells the student, Anya deva tad viditad aviditad adhi. It is something different from all the objects that are known. So it's an unknown object. It's different from something or from all the unknown objects also. It's different from all the known objects, whatever humanity knows. The self is none of it. So it's something unknown. Whatever humanity, whatever we do not know, the self is not that also. Which means objects, things of the world can be divided into what we know and what we do not know. And the self which knows both, knows this one and does not know that one, is different from both. That's why the teacher tells the student, na vidmo na vijanimo yatheta danushishyat. A remarkable teaching from a teacher. He says, so the conclusion, the great conclusion is we do not know how we can teach it to you. Not only that, the teacher says, I do not know the self, Atman, Brahman, and neither can I teach it to you. When the student is getting up ready to go, it is foolish coming here then. We turned up for the last lecture of the season and you say we cannot talk about Brahman, there's nothing to talk about. Swami Vivekananda says in one place, in one of his talks in England, he says, it is beyond the known, but you must not go away. He says, to the audience, you must not go away with the idea that it is unknown. In fact, Swami Vivekananda puts it very powerfully, it is more than known. It is something that is known in and through every experience. First you are the self, you are consciousness, then you are conscious of something. We are consciousness first, then only we are conscious of something. So, it is not an object of experience. The teacher asks the student, so have you understood, have you known the self? Now I have taught you a little bit, have you known it, do you realize it? And the student says, yes, I know it. And the teacher, you can imagine, the teacher is glaring at you. After all this, you say, I know it. It cannot be an object of knowledge. And the student says, wait. It's not that I know it as an object. And it's not that I do not know it either. I both know it and I do not know it. And the teacher is happy. What does he say? Yasya matam tasya matam matam yasya na vedasa. Avijñātam vijānatām, vijñātam avijānatām. Beautiful and completely mystifying. If you get it, it's clear. If you don't get it, it's absolutely mystifying. What does it say? Those who think that they know the Atman, the Self, they do not know it. Those who think that it cannot be known as an object is within brackets, he doesn't say it. Those who think that it cannot be known, they know it. This Self, this pure consciousness which we are, is known to those who do not know it, is unknown to those who know it. Simply, now we understand what it means. Those who think they know it as an object of knowledge, they only know a theory or some kind of feeling or some kind of emotion, some kind of abstract conception. They don't understand what it is really. The famous mystic Nisargadatta, who lived in a Mumbai slum, He was a realized soul, they say. So somebody praised him. You are a Brahmagyani, a knower of Brahman. And Nisargadatta, who was from what I gather, was a rough character. I know only one person who's met him. He's an elderly gentleman who visits us in our Hollywood center. He says he went and met him once, and he's a pretty rough character. So somebody said, oh, you are a knower of Brahman. And Nisargadatta was furious. He said, how dare you insult me? Insult you? That's the highest praise we can think of. in Vedanta that you are a knower of Brahman. He said, no, I'm not a knower of Brahman. I am Brahman. You see, in that itself is the entire teaching we are talking about. If you know Brahman, it's an object for you. And the Upanishad says, not that, neti. And if you think it doesn't exist in that case, not that, neti. It does exist. Now, the teacher tells him, yadvachan abhyuditam yena vaga abhyudyate tadeva brahmatvam vidhi nedam yadidam upasate. That which speech cannot speak about, and because of which you can speak. That which speech cannot express, and yet because of which speech itself is expressed. Know that to be Brahman, not what you worship as this. So profound, so much is packed into it. You cannot speak about it. I gave a talk recently on this, the paradox of language. The language of paradox. Why in Advaita Vedanta the language of paradox is used? Why you cannot speak about it? But that's a subject for different speech. I gave that talk recently, I think, here.
Not here.
In Hollywood. Okay. So, why can we not speak about Brahman or about Atman? So I will not talk about that now. But we cannot, because it's not an object of which can be expressed. But all our speech is expressed by the consciousness illumining our speech. So that which speech cannot express, but which speech depends upon. Every day in the shrine we sing to the Lord. Avang manaso gochara. That you are beyond speech, beyond thought. Manovachanaika adhara. We sing in the evening vespers. The Lord is beyond speech, cannot be expressed by speech, and yet is the very ground upon which speech operates. Without that, we cannot speak. That consciousness within us is the reality, is the self, is what you are, what I am really, and is the same as God. Not, as the teacher says, what you worship out there. You see, this whole science of behind worshipping through images, which you find in Hinduism, the secret is here. Many people misunderstand and say, oh, the Hindus are idolaters or polytheists or they worship. No, clearly in the Upanishads it said, it's not an object you are worshipping. You're not worshipping an object. You are worshipping the same consciousness within all of us with a particular name and form, a divine name and form. With the full awareness, it's not a thing out there. It's not a thing out there. Now we also understand how the prophets of the Old Testament, when they said that you do not be idolaters, the commandments they received from God, that you shall not worship a graven image, means that you don't be an idolater. What is an idolater? The one who worships an object out there as God. The Upanishad says, it is the consciousness within you. You are that. Not a thing, not an object which you are aware of. It is consciousness itself, not the object of consciousness. Yat chakshushana pasyati, yena chakshumshi pasyati, tadeva brahmatvam vidhi nedam yadidam upasate. What the eyes do not see, eyes can never see, and yet because of which we get the ability to see, know that to be Brahman, not what you worship as a thing out there. That consciousness which the eyes cannot see. And yet at this moment, when we use our eyes to see something, it's that consciousness shining through us. Contemplate on the process of perception. Observe the process of perception. There's an object out there. Light falls on it. Light streams into our eyes. Somehow it is transmitted through the optic nerves to the brain. And there somehow the mind takes cognizance of it, of a particular form, which you see out there. There is a clock I can see. The mind, in that mind shines the consciousness, which makes us, gives us a conscious experience. I am seeing a clock. Clock is an object. Eyes are an object. The mind which thinks I am seeing, that's an object. The light which shines in and through all of them is the self which you are. observe the very process of perception, just by observation. What the Upanishad tells us is, you don't need to see a new thing. To realize God, you don't need to see, get a new vision of something called Shiva or Vishnu or Kali. No, not even that. All you need to do is calmly, clearly observe a simple thing like seeing this microphone or seeing a clock, sitting and seeing something. Observe this with clarity. You will find the whole thing depends upon that shining presence that you are. That abiding, shining presence which never changes. Try this experiment. Look at this microphone. All right. Look at this light. All right. Look at this hand. All right. The microphone is different. The light is different. The hand is different. It's the same pair of eyes which saw all these different things. Go deeper. Become aware of your eyes. Become aware of your skin. Become aware of sense of smell. Become aware of the sense of taste. 5 different senses. It's the same mind which is watching all of them. Go deeper. Thoughts are coming in your mind. Good thoughts, not so good thoughts. I understand what this guy is saying. I don't understand what this guy is saying. I am bored. I am sleepy. All these are thoughts coming up in the mind. It is the same unchanging consciousness aware of the various thoughts of the mind. Just by observing the process of perception, one can come to an understanding of what we really are. That unchanging consciousness is what we really are. All changes are in the world. All changes are in the body. That young child, the teenager, that middle-aged person, that old person, all of those refer to the body. All changes are in the psychic, physical, the vital body. Health, energy, sickness, tiredness, vital body. All changes are in the mind. So many thoughts and feelings coming and going in the mind. So many memories, so many things we know, so many things we have learned, so many things we have forgotten. They're all changes in the mind. But the consciousness which watches all these changes of the mind, of the vital body, of the physical body, of the world outside, there are no changes in that consciousness. That unblinking eye, Aurobindo called it the white glare. The white glare of a divine radiance, he called it. It's very poetic. That white glare of a divine radiance is within, is what we are. So that by which we see, that by which we hear, is that consciousness. Now the teacher says, when do we experience it? Pratibodha viditam matam amritatvam hi vindate. By being aware of this, every moment in every experience, mortal man becomes immortal. You win immortality, reach the goal of life. What does he mean? In every experience, this consciousness alone shines through. Whether you are seeing something, hearing something, speaking, just become aware of this. When I see something, when I'm seeing a microphone, our normal reaction is, the normal way we take it, okay, I'm looking at a microphone or I'm looking at a person. What Vedanta wants us to do, what the teacher is telling us to do is, you be aware of the object, but also be aware of your consciousness being aware of the object. In every experience, realize you are that unchanging consciousness. How do I overcome anger? Use the same process. Anger, are you aware of your anger? Yes, I'm aware of my anger. In that case, anger is an object. You are the consciousness shining upon the anger. I am angry. I am angry is a thought shining in the same consciousness. The consciousness is not angry. The moment we become aware of this, you will find something remarkable. The mind which is angry also settles down. The mind which is sad also quietens down. The mind which is restless becomes calm. It is an immediate effect. It's only when we identify ourselves with the mind that the mind becomes restless. When you step back from the mind into your true self, that is consciousness, stepping back is not a physical stepping back, but disidentifying with the mind and realizing your true identity with the unchanging consciousness. When you do that, he says, pratibodha. When do you do that? In every experience. Whatever you're doing. Walking, talking, hearing. Whenever, you say, I forget. Doesn't matter. The moment you remember, be aware that I am the consciousness in aware, shining upon all these experiences. Being aware of the unchanging consciousness, noting the unchanging consciousness, recognizing that unchanging consciousness within us. I keep saying within us, but actually we should claim that I am that unchanging consciousness. Don't say my unchanging consciousness, like it's my liver or my kidney. I am that unchanging consciousness. Earlier I thought I am a body and a mind with consciousness. Now try to think I am consciousness shining through a body and mind. Body is changing, aging, will die one day. No problem. Really no problem. Mind is changing, sometimes happy, sometimes sad, sometimes restless, sometimes concentrated, sometimes spiritual, sometimes totally non-spiritual. No problem. I, the consciousness, am the very essence of spirituality. What all the religions in the world, what all Vedanta is trying to do is to realize what I am all the time. I'm already it. I am that all the time. So that consciousness, when we become aware of it in every movement of life, then mortal man becomes immortal. That is the promise of the Upanishad. Swami Vivekananda said, my mission, now we can understand him, my mission can be put in a few words. It is to preach unto mankind, it's to preach unto humanity, their inner divinity and how to make it manifest in every movement of life. When we become aware of this inner divinity, how do you become aware of it? Through any experience, by the process we just talked about. Then automatically it starts manifesting. All problems slowly and steadily get resolved. Problems of anger, jealousy, sadness, misery. All of them are out there in the body and mind. Nothing to do with me. I am aware of them. I just shine upon them. You see, they get resolved by themselves. You transcend them. Here is one more point I'd like to make. I keep using the word, and Upanishads also use the word, transcend. The Sanskrit word atimuchya. Realizing the unchanging consciousness within, the sage transcends this body and mind. But what do you mean by transcends? Goes beyond this body and mind. One must understand this carefully. It's simple enough, but there is a possibility of misunderstanding. When you say something, normally say something is beyond something. Los Angeles is beyond San Diego. Then what we mean is, here is a place called San Diego, and there, outside San Diego, a couple of hours drive, depending on traffic, is is another place different from San Diego called Los Angeles. Now, when you say, I transcend the body and mind, people make a mistake thinking that, okay, I have to leave the body and mind, you know, like a little mist or something will come out of the body and mind. That's spirituality. No. In the case of Vedanta, it's not two different things. It's not a consciousness apart, away from body and mind. Rather, what transcending in Vedanta means is being unattached, not affected. Right here, right now, in the body and mind, completely unaffected by the changes of the body and mind, yet shining in and through the body and mind, enabling the body and mind to do what they are meant to do. Exactly like you keep some dirt and mud here, some holy picture here, the light which shines upon the holy picture and the light which shines upon the dirt or the mud. The light is not made impure by that. The light is not made pure by that. It's right there. The light is right there. It's completely unaffected. The traditional in Sanskrit, they give the example of a pot. Usually you find lots of pots in Vedanta because that's what they mostly had. I mean, you go to an ancient civilization, you dig up archaeology. What is the first thing that you dig up? Pottery. Yes. So they had lots of, I guess, thousands of years later, if people start digging up stuff from our civilization, they'll find iPhones or something like that, mobile phones. So here's a pot full of wine or dirty water. Here's a pot full of Ganges water, what they could think about, the holiest thing they could think about. Pot full of Ganges water and a pot full of dirty water. Water from the sewage. Now, the Ganges water in that pot actually purifies it. They say you purifies the pot itself. It becomes something holy and nice and elevating. And the sewage water is not only dirty, it makes that container dirty too. But The example is, the space which is occupied by the pot where you keep the pot of Ganges water. The space is neither purified nor made impure. Remove the pot of Ganges water, bring in the pot of sewage water, put it there. That space doesn't become dirty or impure. The space is completely untouched by what occupies that space, what you put in that space. You understand? The space is not made impure. It's like a screen on which you play a movie. You play a tragedy and you play a comedy. Now the screen will not protest that I'm too sad after the tragedy. I can't laugh. The screen is unaffected. The screen does two things. It is unaffected by the movie you play on it, number one. Number two, it is right there where you are playing the movie. And it in fact enables you to play the movie. Without the screen, there's no movie. Similarly, the consciousness that you are completely unaffected by the birth and death, health and illness of the body and of the prana, completely unaffected by the sorrow or the happiness of the mind, and yet it's right there, just like the screen. And it enables the body to function and the mind to function. When we realize that we are not the body, not the mind, we are that consciousness, the immortal man becomes immortal. That is what is called transcendence in Vedanta. It does not mean two different things. It does not mean walking away from your body and mind. You know, keep the body and mind there, now I have transcended the body and mind. No. Right there. I have seen a Swami with my own eyes, and just came to me in a hospital. A very old Swami, few years before he passed away, he was, both of his legs were paralyzed, blind in both eyes. I think one arm was also paralyzed. And he was sick like that for nearly 10 years before he died. I can see people saying, oh, terrible. And he's one of the most joyous persons I've ever seen. Laluda Maharaj was in Arogya Bhavan. Disciple of Swami Vijnanandaji, one of the direct disciples of Sri Ramakrishna. One of the most vigorously joyful persons I have met. Not once I stayed in the same room with him for nearly two months. About a month. Not once did I hear this person whose body was a wreck. Not once did I hear him complaining about the body or the mind, about anything. Never. Anybody who came, he would encourage them. You would have to tell him who you are because he can't see you. I am so and so. And he would ask about you. Never ever talk about the body or the mind. Simply that he was unaware of the terrible problems in his body. I felt when I saw that, this is called transcendence. Being right there, in that body, in that life, and completely at peace with it. Yes. So, that is transcendence. And what will be the result? Iha cheda vedit atha satyam asti. No chediha vedit mahati vinashti. It concludes with this. The teacher's teaching concludes to the student by saying this. In this body, right now, today, in this life, if you realize it, you have realized the goal of human life. You have realized what life is meant for. And if you do not realize it, he said, unless you realize it in this life itself, no post-mortem realization, after death I'll go on. No, unless we realize it in this life itself, he says, then it's ominous. Mahati vinashti, great is your loss. Why great is your loss? Then we'll be whirled through the cycle of births and deaths again and again and again. Right now we have the opportunity. Let us realize ourselves as not the body and mind and bring this cycle of this existences to an end. Our true, immortal, infinite consciousness, our nature. Let us realize it and abide in it. Otherwise, one Swami put it very nicely, funnily, he says, you have a choice. Realize it and you are G-O-D. Don't realize it, you are D-O-G. God or dog. Because the Hindu idea is we go through many births. God knows what will happen in the next birth or the birth after that. I think this was a good theme to talk about in the concluding talk about of this season. The idea of experiencing God in and through every experience. Not the object of experience, but the subject of experience. That is what we are. Let us claim our spiritual heritage. We will get, what we will get is immediate peace, the ability to transcend. Now you understand what sense transcend? Transcend suffering. Not put a stop to suffering. Transcend suffering. We know at the level of the body suffering continues. At the level of the mind also suffering may continue. When you see yourself as being different from that, while remaining within that, you will find actually the level of suffering goes down. And you are at one, in a real sense beyond that suffering all the time. This is the promise of Vedanta. In this very life, I pray to Sri Ramakrishna, the Holy Mother. May the Lord bless us with this realization in this very life. Thank you very much.